Hello and welcome to the big picture. The increasing dependence on the judiciary to decide the fate of politicians and the role of the CBI has led to a situation where accountability has come under question. What democratic accountability means in the present situation? When people in positions of power find themselves accused or suspected of wrongdoings, the reflex action in the past was to resign from their positions and seek an inquiry and get themselves cleared, if possible. The reflex action in the present days is to challenge and resist giving up their post as long as they can. The obduracy of the ruling party is to let go the ones accused or suspected of wrongdoing, and the hastiness of the opposition party is to demand resignation and hold the parliament and legislature to ransom, have all led to a huge cynicism among the people. The biggest setback from these developments is to the concept of democratic accountability. Is the political class now lost its morality and instead find judiciary and the CBI to hide itself? We will discuss all this and the issues surrounding the present impasse brought about in the parliament over the demand for resignations of the ministers. To discuss this, I have with me Nilotpal Basu, Central Committee member of the CPIM, Vinod Sharma, political editor of the Hindustan Times. We will be joined by others soon. Nilotpal, first coming to you, you know, the concept of democratic accountability, does it now rest on whether the judiciary or the CBI finds people, you know, hold them accountable and hold them guilty until and unless that happens, people will continue merrily in their positions? Is that what has happened to the issue, the concept of democratic accountability now?
Girish, the heart of the parliamentary democratic system rests on the accountability of the executive to the legislature.
Right.
That is what our constitution makers have pointed out unambiguously. But unfortunately, what is happening, that the executive, which in itself is a product and based on the majority it enjoys in the legislature, which ought to have drawn its strength and its moral fiber from its sense of accountability, display of accountability to the legislature, is shirking from that responsibility. And thereby, both the executive and legislature are getting weakened. Their respective powers are getting undermined. As a result of that, a void is created, and that void is being increasingly filled up by the judiciary. I could not agree more with you that the result is a casualty of the basic moral fiber of the overall political system.
Okay. Basic moral fiber, Vinod. Basic moral fiber has changed. We all know that, you know, it's not just among the politicians, the political parties, the society itself, the moral fiber has changed. But the society, the people still expect certain standards from politicians. And you can't blame them for it, right?
Well, I think that it is very much in order that the people we elect to parliament or to state legislatures measure up to our expectations. And I think those expectations are about making the government accountable through adequate functioning of the legislature. The legislature itself being above board in terms of credibility, in terms of its acceptability to the people. Now, what's happening is, you see...
And the executive.
You see, in the good old days, you see the value system that was created by the legislature itself, and the political parties contributed so much to that value system, where members of parliament or ministers specifically, if they came under a cloud, they stepped down or offered to step down till the time that the name was cleared.
Cleared.
And I think it was very much the right thing to do. You see, people often cite the example of Lal Bahadur Shastri in later years, Madhurao Sindhya, even L.K. Advani. But most recently, Veerbhadra Singh.
Yes.
When there was a charge against him, he immediately quit his cabinet
and
position.
He became the chief minister
and went and contested the election, and has been since exonerated in that case, both in the court and also the court of the people. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's now the prime chief minister of that state. So I think that there are fine examples, there are fine precedents, which political parties must follow, And I think the onus for following those fine precedents is more at a given point of time on the party that is in power.
Absolutely.
And I think instead of creating a situation, the opposition must creating a situation where the ruling party stands on prestige and doesn't want to be seen as acting under pressure from the opposition. The opposition must, in its conduct, create a situation where there is enough elbow room for the ruling party to adhere to the best practices without seeming to wilt under pressure from the opposition. And that can only happen, and I can't grudge paying a compliment to the left, that they too react to wrongs that are committed by the executive, by the government of the day, but their response is very measured. And it isn't belligerent, it isn't insulting or derisive. It is basically about the fair thing to do. And that's what I think parliament debate is all about.
I mean, I think you've made a very, very interesting point. Let me get, we are joined in now by Bhartruhari Mahtab, the BJD MP in the Lok Sabha. Mr. Mahtab, you know, you must have heard what Vinod was saying. It's very interesting. You know, the onus of taking onus of accountability, taking responsibility for, is certainly more on the party which is in power. But sometimes, don't you think the opposition parties also create a situation where they don't give any elbow room to the ruling party to take a decision? Like in the present case, it has become a prestige issue. The ruling party doesn't want to, yield. The opposition party also, on the other hand, doesn't want to yield. So we see this, impasse in parliament, which is affecting a lot of, very important business.
It is no doubt affecting the business. There were a lot of business to be conducted.
Yes.
But the impasse is not the creation of the opposition. The ruling alliance or the treasury bench could have taken certain measures, which I believe very sincerely, to break the ice, which they are not doing. Rather, they are more persistent to get things done in the melee, which we have been repeatedly saying, don't try to pass any bill without discussion. Don't try to bamboozle any bill.
Mr. Mahtab, we are on a larger issue now. We are not on this particular issue of the bill being passed and things like that. We are looking at the issue of democratic accountability. Where does this issue of accountability come in here? You know, how does it happen? Like I was, before you came in, we were discussing about, in the past, the reflex action was somebody is found suspected of wrongdoing or found to be caught doing some wrong. The reflex action was to resign and wait for an inquiry. Now the reflex action is to hold on to power. Every political party which is in power also continues to support that person who is holding on to power.
Now today, any individual does not matter. It is the party leadership which takes the decision.
Right.
Earlier, it was individual opinion which was actually guiding factor to take a decision.
Right.
But today, as you have seen, there are two cabinet ministers in the union government who have offered to resign, as is reported in the media, but they have been told not to resign. So whom should we blame? We should blame the leadership of the Treasury bench, that they have denied, that they have in a way asked the ministers not to resign. Earlier, even today, in different provincial governments, when there is a shadow of corruption on any minister, they have been either thrown out of the government or they have been asked to resign from the government.
But Mr. Mahtab, there are also many instances where similar things have happened in the provincial governments where they refused to resign, which we have seen in some states in the past, very recently, like in West Bengal also, or many other places. Let me bring Nilotpal on this. Nilotpal, what Mr. Mahtab says, he makes a very interesting point. It is no more the individual, the parties now decide whether one should resign or not.
You see, first of all, I think Vinod was earlier making an important point about the moral shin of the present generation of politicians. I think it is more than a case of moral digression, what we see when they seem to be reluctant in being accountable and in demitting office when they come under the cloud of suspicion. I think the changes that we are witnessing today is the result of certain structural changes. The way corporates and corporate money has come to hijack the whole business of governance, this is an inevitable outcome. For example, I cannot really agree with Mr. Mahtab, because it's not a question, a partisan question. You see, the influence of such corporate money and authoring of government policies are really hijacked by a very powerful nexus of corporates, bureaucrats, politicians, and this complete degeneration of political standards is an inevitable outcome. The other point that I would like to make is that it is very ironical, you see, the executive is supposed to draw its strength from its accountability to the legislature. Now precisely by not being accountable to the legislature, they are also lowering their own standards and they are undermining their own existence. For example, you see, I do agree that the opposition, particularly in this case, needs to rethink its strategy. It is no doubt that the obduracy of the government in responding to certain standards that is imposed by the exigencies of the situation should have been responded to by the ministers and by the ruling dispensation. But at the same time, I mean, blocking the parliament for days together, I don't think it is also going down well with the people. Ultimately, the credibility of the legislature itself depends on how it is perceived by the people at large.
Mr. Mahtab, how do you react to this? You know, the opposition also needs to have a strategy. It is not just being seen as, you know, pushing the government to the wall. That is not just the strategy which the opposition can undertake.
I'll just explain to you the facts. Today, you must have seen, even yesterday, when there was an attempt at 3 o'clock in the afternoon to have the food security bill discussed and passed, that time there were number of opposition members in the well. Some were shouting for the resignation of the Prime Minister. Some were also raising for establishment of SIT relating to 84 Sikh, anti-Sikh riots. There were some others who were asking for Sachar committee recommendation to be implemented. So the opposition who were there in the well of the house, and I should tell you, there was also one other party which was in the well, which supports this government from outside. So it was a divided opposition which wanted to say in the well of the house that food security bill should not be passed in the din. But what had happened, it continued for 16 to 20 minutes and then the house was adjourned. This could have been sorted out by the treasury bench much earlier by having a discussion with the opposition leaders. But the problem today is nobody is sitting together to thrash out how to have the house run. That is the problem. Okay. We are not, as a opposition party, we are not in support of disrupting the proceedings of the house. We want house to function.
So okay. So the accountability, the issue of accountability is not just about the party in power, but also party opposition also has to be accountable to the legislature from where it also functions from. Anyway, we'll discuss this further. We need to go into a short break now. Please keep watching. We'll come back and continue the discussion. Welcome back. We are discussing the issue of democratic accountability in the context of what we have been witnessing in the parliament for the last several days. Vinod, you know, Nilotpal raised certain issues. The corporatization, the corporate culture is also affecting these kind of things. Do you think that we can bring, when questions of morality is there, does it not Is it in any way connected to the way the corporates are now involved in all these things?
No, he's only broadly referring to the decline of value system, which gave Parliament the hello, which belonged to it in the earlier years. You see, in this case, I think the ground rules need to be discussed by all political parties that are represented in the House.
No, one second. One second. See, we are discussing the present impasse in Parliament and, the issue of resignation of these two ministers. But this is exactly what happens, whoever is in power. We have witnessed this happening
That's why I'm saying, look at the position of the CPIM. They want action from the Prime Minister, resignation of Ashwini Kumar. The BJP wants Ashwini Kumar and the Prime Minister both to resign. I do not know what position the BJD has, but I haven't heard them demanding the resignation of the Prime Minister. Now, if a political party is all alone in demanding the resignation of the Prime Minister, then I think rather than stalling the House, that political party should bring a no-trust vote against the Prime Minister. That's the parliamentary instrumentality that is available to it. Even if it is lost, you have made a point.
You made a point.
And there would be a debate on it in the House. The sanctity of the House would be maintained, a point would be made, and you would be and the PM will be within the firing range. Now, I wonder that by boycotting the proceedings of the House, and they are well within their rights to do it. I mean, I'm not for a moment suggesting that they are not within their rights to do it. But we are discussing here as to what picture does it convey to the people outside who elect our members of parliament to represent their cases, and they are accountable. You see, these members of parliament are accountable to the constituents. You see, they may not be accountable the way the government is accountable to parliament, but they are also accountable to the constituents.
Right.
And if there is an important social legislation, and look at people as important as Amartya Sen and Yon Dres and others have made a point at a press conference yesterday that please don't, make these bills a casualty to the tug of war that's going on in the House. I mean, come to a determination, okay, fine, we'll pass these legislations, yet we will insist and we will not give up our demand for the resignation of the ministers who are under a cloud.
Nilotpal, an ironical situation has developed now. Everything, when these kind of situations arise, whoever is on the firing range says that, let the judiciary decide or let the CBI decide. One day CBI is seen as the culprit. The next day, people want CBI inquiry on that. One day, the people have serious reservations about the way judiciary approaches certain things. Then the next day, you say that let the judiciary decide. All this is leading to a confusing situation. The entire political class is not really bringing about any faith in these major institutions.
I will make three quick points. First of all, this government is behaving like a Kalidas. You see, removal of ministers is the exclusive prerogative of the Prime Minister. When ministers have been found clearly prima facie of misdemeanor, of wrongdoing, it is very much within the powers of the Prime Minister to take care.
Yeah.
But it is not doing so. Allegedly because that will bring the Prime Minister in the firing line. I don't know how far it is true. Perhaps Vinod has more insights. He can enlighten us. The second question, which is so very important, where we clearly demarcate with the BJP. Now, while agreeing with Mr. Mahtab that yes, the government is obdurate, I mean government is primarily responsible for this, but ultimately, it is BJP which is obliging the government. Because for the government, nothing can be sweeter and more music-like if they don't have to face the parliament. Because they are answerable to the parliament. For example, on the coal question, we have not yet got the official version of the government on the floor of the House.
Right.
You see, Supreme Court is hearing the affidavit of the CBI and that of the government, but you see where it ought to be discussed and where I believe there is an excellent report by the Joint Parliamentary Committee on coal, which has torn the government apart those things are not being discussed. So ultimately, it is happy times for the government eventually.
Yeah, I think you made an interesting point. Let me get Mehtab in on this. I think you made a, Mr. Mehtab, in fact, the opposition party or the BJP, one of who used to be our ally, now you can safely say that they are not our allies. You know, the main opposition party is just letting the government go very, you know, easily.
To a certain extent, yes. But it's not only BJP. Even today, I saw the communists also jumping to the well to stall the house. Hmm. It has affected everyone. If the house doesn't function, the executive is not answerable. When questions are put, for actually the question hour, one of our members was going to ask the first question. He stood up. He asked the supplementary. But the minister stood up and indicated to the speaker, saying that I am unable to hear anything. If this is the situation in a house, actually the whole system of parliamentary democracy today has become a farce. And people, there is no doubt people are losing faith in parliamentary democracy. Practically, I would say we have failed to demonstrate our willpower to have parliamentary democracy in this country.
Okay. I mean, that's a very serious thing. A parliamentarian of your experience and standing, when he says that, I can understand the frustration behind what you're saying. Vinod?
You know, may I say something? You see, amid all this hullabaloo and this din and bustle and the sparks flying, you know, luckily the Lok Sabha has extended the tenure of the JPC that went into the 2G. But, you know, its tenure was to end on the 10th.
Yes.
And there was at one stage a thinking on both sides to let the JPC lapse so that there is no report. And so both sides have their say and they would get whatever they want, get a clean sheet or not have any indictment from the JPC against them. So I think that, you know, frankly, I think the parliamentarians and more the government, I mean, there's no question of sparing the government on this, because I think institutions are more important, governments come and go. Individuals are not important, institutions are important. Now, Nilotpal was asking as to why the Prime Minister, you know, why is it that the Prime Minister is not accepting the resignation
exactly.
of Ashwini Kumar.
The point made by Mehtab earlier also.
You see, the point is that the BJP has sought the resignation of Ashwini Kumar and the PM in the same breath. Now, the logical conclusion is that if Ashwini Kumar is resigning, if the Ashwini Kumar is sacked, you are asking for resignation of both of them together. Now you are perhaps precluding even the prime ministerial prerogative, negating it to sack him, because he is also being sought to be resigned to resign from now.
So this
now
is
the BJP is making a distinction.
This is a tactical mistake.
And his charge as the coal minister. They are saying we are not asking for the resignation of the prime minister. We are asking for the resignation of the then coal minister. Now I think it's too funny for any kind of logic
yes.
to be made. You know.
So
you see, by seeking the resignation of both together, I think they have secured the position of Mr. Ashwini Kumar, and I think that is perhaps suits their strategy, because it will continue. The logjam will continue longer, and at times it is the strategy of the opposition to prolong the logjam rather than break it.
Mr. Mehtab, yes, we can come in.
Yesterday, BJP came out very clearly that they want the resignation of the law minister and also of the rail minister.
Right.
So that food security bill can be discussed and they are willing to pass it.
Right.
They have come out with this statement.
Yes.
Regarding the resignation of Prime Minister, I would say it has really become very funny. For last 4 years, BJP has been asking for the resignation of the Prime Minister.
In every session. Yes.
So why should everyone take that? Nobody is taking that very seriously.
That is exactly the point which I was trying to make earlier when we started this discussion, that you know the on the part of the opposition also, there is no, as Vinod was pointing out,
Girish,
this kind of tactical mistakes made by the opposition also doesn't help matters.
Girish?
Yes, yes.
I think yes, you Nilo. Are time and again referring to opposition as a homogeneous.
Nilotpal, that distinction has been very clearly made by Vinod at the right at the beginning. He has told that you are more responsible.
Unfortunately,
we don't have the BJP member on the panel today.
let me make the point very clear. We understand that the Prime Minister of the country can be removed only in two circumstances. One is if in the Lok Sabha is a majority which does not support his government, the Prime Minister has to go, or else we have to wait for the general election where the Prime Minister's party does not get the majority and he is not in a position
to make. You know,
so therefore, or otherwise, you have to at least try and see by moving a no confidence motion.
Absolutely.
The Prime Minister as such does not make any sense.
Okay.
So one last point.
Last, very quickly.
I think the opposition, now, as you said, that the opposition is not a monolithic entity. It, you know, there are different political parties. And when there is a logjam, when there is one political party hell-bent on disruption or stalling the house proceedings, they are actually also curtailing the rights of other political parties who have a different perception of the situation.
Okay, Vinod,
and that is why I think an all-party meeting to have this thing sorted out is very necessary.
Okay, Vinod.
But at the same time, government must reciprocate.
Sorry.
Yes, of course.
Nilotpal, it is over. We have completely run out of time. This has been an interesting discussion. There are problems in this, in the impasse which is going on. But both the government and the opposition party, and the opposition, as Nilotpal rightly points out, is not a monolith. So the other opposition parties should also get together and see that this impasse ends and the work of the parliament continues. But there is the larger issue of democratic accountability still needs much further debate. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. Nilotpal Basu, Bhartruhari Mahtab and Vinod Sharma. Please keep watching. Tomorrow we will have the results of the Karnataka Assembly elections. So keep watching throughout the day for what comes from Karnataka.